was a long drive. I came all the way from Hope Chapel. Man, it was a long drive. It's my joy and honor to preach the gospel to my beloved brothers and sisters at Lock Raven Presbyterian Church. And why don't we bow in prayer? Lord Jesus, we're so undone without your word. Speak to us and let us live, because your word gives life, and we need your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I studied with Scotty Smith in my doctoral program, and he said many encouraging things during the program, but recently his prayer book came out, so I picked it up out of joy and I put it in my prayer room. And the following day, I opened it up to pray and confess my sins to the Lord. And this was the first thing I read. He said, "It's critical to realize that when we confess our sins, we never inform or shock God. We are simply agreeing with what God already knows." How true. This indicates that God is sovereign. God's sovereignty is such a big topic, and it's related to God's omniscience. The Almighty is also all-knowing. Unless you're all-knowing, you cannot be almighty, and vice versa. It implies that God looks into our hearts. God does not simply plan things ahead and execute them, but he knows my heart. Meaning, he cannot be deceived. Deuteronomy 28:47-48 reads, "Because you did not serve the Lord your God with joyfulness and gladness of heart, because of the abundance of all things, therefore you shall serve your enemies whom the Lord will send against you in hunger and thirst, in nakedness, in lacking everything, and he will put a yoke of iron on your neck until he has destroyed you." Is God happy? No, he's offended. Why is he offended? Because God looks into our hearts. So when God made the first covenant with the Israelites, the covenant stipulation was not only about their behavior, but it was also about their joy. They were supposed to be glad in the Lord. What God really wanted was that they obey out of joy. That's the only way to honor God. I asked Mindy, my second child, to wipe off the study table in the family room. It's not that I need her to do this for me. Trust me, I used to serve tables throughout high school and college in different restaurants. So wiping off a table, come on, it's easier than breathing. I could just wipe off a table with my eyes closed. I'm good at it. I don't need Mindy to do that for me. But I still ask her to do it so she will grow into a healthy child and learn how to obey me. Then she has two choices. Wipe off the table, humming some of her favorite songs, like 10,000 Reasons, and tells me, "It's done, Daddy." And I go, "Thank you, Mindy. And she says, "My pleasure." Then it honors me because she does it out of joy. But if she does it grudgingly, going like this, mumbling to herself, why is he asking me to do all these things? I hate it. And I still say, "Thank you, Mindy." And she goes, "I know. I hate doing these things, especially when I want to play some games on my iPad, but I still did it for you." Then it dishonors me because she didn't do it out of joy. So it is with us. If we fail to obey God out of joy, we dishonor him. And we could sin as we preach behind the pulpit, as we sing at church, as we serve our children's ministry downstairs, even as we give, if we give grudgingly, out of compulsion, with no joy. The book of Jeremiah is about God's impending judgment on the Judahites and his grand vision of restoration. God's going to punish them, but he's going to restore them. And the more you read the book of Jeremiah, the more you realize that the Judahites' sin was not just their sinful behavior, but it was their heart issue. They persistently sinned against God because they did not want to listen to God. There was no joy, no gladness. So when God shares his grand vision with Jeremiah to save his people from their sins, he makes the new covenant, which is today's passage. The content of the new covenant, that's what we have to talk about first. And I have 2 points for that. Number one, God is sovereign. God is sovereign. Verses 40 and 41. "I will make with them an everlasting covenant, that I will not turn away from doing good to them, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts, that they may not turn from me. I'll rejoice in doing them good, and I'll plant them in this land in faithfulness with all my heart and all my soul." As you can see, God does it all. "I will, I will, I will." And when God says, "I will," he will definitely make it happen. I told my wife, Jade, the other day, that I'm going to be home by 9:15, and I couldn't keep the promise because someone stole my car. So I got home at 11. Not only because I had to make a police report and all these things, but also because I had to find the transportation. You know, I can't fly. And did Jade get mad at me, wife get mad at me? Because I failed to get home by 9:15. "You promised you'll be home by 9:15. How could you let me down like that?" She wasn't like that at all. She wasn't angry at me at all. Why not? Because I was just being human. Someone stole my car. Did I see that coming? Nope. However, God of the Bible is not like that. He is not surprised by anything. He never says, "I didn't know that," or "I didn't see that coming." Or he wouldn't apologize to us saying, "Sorry, I just dropped the ball. Sorry, that won't happen again." Or he's not going to say, "I know I said it 20 years ago, but sorry, I changed my mind." You know, we have the internet nowadays, and people have a computer in their pocket, and it's pretty hard to be a God these days. You gotta understand. He doesn't say that. God does not say any of these things because he is sovereign, which means his words bring results no matter what. Numbers 23:19 reads, God is not man that he should lie, or son of man that he should change his mind. Has he said and will he not do it? Or has he spoken and will he not fulfill it? Man is consistently inconsistent, but God is consistent, period, according to the Bible. It means the Word of God is the final authority we have. As he said it, God is unchanging, so his word is irreversible. And that's the spirit of the new covenant. The covenant will not be broken. Because I promised. Verse 40. I'll make with them an everlasting covenant that I will not turn away from doing good to them. God says that the new covenant will be fulfilled, so it's called the everlasting covenant. Why would God make the eternal covenant with the Israelites? In order that he himself will be ministering to his people without ceasing. God himself is committed to it forever. No wonder it's an everlasting covenant. And some people could go, why would God make any covenant with humans? If it's God. God is sovereign, yet he puts himself in this box as if he's making a stone that he cannot remove. Is God creating something that he cannot overcome? Why would God make this everlasting covenant that he cannot break for himself? That's a good question. And this will take us to the following point. Number two, God is not only sovereign, he is happy. God is happy. Verse 41 reads, I'll rejoice in doing them good, and I'll plant them in this land in faithfulness, with all my heart and all my soul. When God keeps the covenant, he'll be joyful. He won't be grumbling as if someone's twisting his arms, or he won't be depressed as if he's been defeated by anyone. He will keep the covenant out of joy. Then God's faithfulness, him keeping the covenant with all his heart and all his soul, is traced to his joy, his happiness. This is not simply about God being faithful or diligent, but it's about his pleasure. He takes pleasure in keeping the covenant. He does it with his whole being, because he loves it. These two things go hand in hand, God's joy and his faithfulness. So God is a happy God, and the same happy God is the covenant-keeping God. Psalm 135:6 reads, whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps. Isaiah 45:7, I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. Good things and bad things, positive things and negative things. You're healthy, you're sick. Who did that? I'm a happy God, he says. Why would God say these things? To disclose himself to us. How magnificent he is. How awesome he is. He doesn't need anyone's approval. He doesn't need anyone's yes. Then God's sovereignty means he's a happy God. He doesn't need anyone's permission or approval. Therefore, the sovereign God makes the everlasting covenant that he may not turn away from doing good to his people. It implies that he's making the new covenant in order that he will rejoice in doing good to them. Meaning, he's a happy God even as he keeps the covenant. Then God is not restrained by the covenant, but God takes pleasure in keeping the covenant. He's happy about that. He does whatever he wants to do, and nobody could stop him from doing it. So he's a happy God. He's a happy God in his sovereignty. Then God's sovereignty and his pleasure are inseparable. So the two main points are God's sovereign and God is happy. And these two things talks about the same thing, which is the content of the new covenant. What's that? God's sovereign pleasure. God is happy to his glory. Now, for our application, we get it. The Almighty God displays his sovereign pleasure through the new covenant, but what does this mean to us, the 21st century Christians? If we simply say, wow, God is sovereign, he's a happy God, and it's even better, he made a covenant with his people, so let's trust him. If we just stop there, that's problematic. Why? Because that's not how you're supposed to respond to the new covenant, especially on this side of the cross. You could have said that on that side of the cross. If you believe in Judaism, you might have said that. I don't mean to belittle Judaism, but we're standing on this side of the cross and we're Christians. We should do better than that. Let's see what the New Testament says, Hebrews 9, 14, and 15. So the Old Testament animal sacrifice set apart God's people as holy. That's the context. How much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of the new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. Now, what makes Christ the mediator of the new covenant? At the cross, Christ purified those who are called, the elect, from their conscience, from dead works. Our conscience is designed to be the eternal sin detector. Unless you're radically hardened, your conscience kicks in, at least when you do something wrong. You hear the voice? You can't lie like that. You can't watch that stuff, even when no one's around. You hear that. That's your conscience speaking to you. However, Christ purified our conscience from dead works, meaning he set our conscience free from the guilt-driven, legalistic, old conscience. By dying on the cross, yes, he purified our sins. Yes, he cleansed us. Yes, he reconciled us to God. How did he do that? He ratified the new heart, and he cleansed our conscience so that from now on, we could obey God out of joy. We would obey God because we love to obey God. We obey God because we desire to obey God. Our conscience has changed. That's how you serve the living God with the new conscience. God is not dead, so your dead conscience has no place in the kingdom of God. You come to him with the living conscience. Then our new conscience would go off, not only as you do something wrong, but it makes you desire to obey God and enjoy him. So you obey because you want to obey. You obey because you love God. That's what today's passage means. Verse 40, and I'll put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. The word fear means our holy reverence toward God, not being terrified. When I was little, 5 or 6 years old, I loved it when my dad's in the house on his day off. I was enjoying his presence because I loved him. And at the same time, that meant I behave better because my dad's in the house. I was not terrified, but he was a hero to me. He was so strong. He was so good at gymnastics, and he was so perfect in all things. I wanted to be like him. He was so perfect, even when he was angry. He was fair to me. So what did I do? I lovingly revered him. So I behaved accordingly. Of course, when he was not home, I was the man. But at any rate, you see what the passage means? God changed our emotions. God gave us the appropriate affection toward him so that we obey him out of joy. Remember, he's that sovereign. And how did God do that? By becoming a man and dying on the cross. God the Son ratified a new heart in us that we may enjoy him and love him and never even think of leaving him. So when you obey his commandments, and the church says, thank you for your service, what do you say? My pleasure. That's what I felt this morning. I came to Lock Raven. I needed some help at the sound booth with the visual stuff, and they were doing things to serve the church. And I told them, thank you. And they went, no problem. Where's that from? It's from the new heart, new conscience. So back to the application question, what does the new covenant mean to us, the 21st century Christians? Number one, rejoice always. Rejoice always. As you know, on this side of the cross, God commands rejoice always. 1 Thessalonians passage, Philippians passage, you name it. God says it over and over again. Rejoice. Not only when things are perfect, not only when things go well. We're called to rejoice even when people revile us, persecute us, and utter all kinds of evil falsely on Jesus' account. He said, rejoice and be glad. So, for Christians, joy is a command. It's not an option. Joy is a command. Why? Because being a Christian means being a worshiper of the living God in every area of our lives. Let me put it this way. You rejoice not only as you obey the word of God in your church community on Sundays, on Wednesdays, but as you obey the word of God outside the church community. That's what rejoice always means. Not to mention unemployment, cancer, marriage issue, addiction, parenting issue. These things cannot stop us from the love of Christ, so you worship Him by being joyful. On this side of the cross, you ought to be joyful always. And you could wonder, I understand, we worship the living God when we are joyful. But it's challenging for me to rejoice always. I could rejoice sometimes. Trust me, I do. Many times I have the joy of the Lord, but sometimes I can't rejoice. I wish I can. But it's very challenging. You want to hear me out? How could I rejoice when my loved one gets shot just because he's black? Or how could I rejoice when my job is underappreciated? I work 12-hour shift. I do everything I can to protect our citizens from bad guys. I'm willing to sacrifice my life for the sake of my community. But people just believe everything they see on Facebook or TV and despise me and even my family just because I'm wearing my uniform. How could I be joyful? Or you could say this, it's not so hard for me to decide who to vote for. It's obvious to me. But I can't understand why they would vote for that candidate and they call themselves Christians. I get frustrated. Some of us say that. Or some of the others go, how could I be joyful when my country is so divided? I can't vote for anyone. None of them is good enough to lead my country. How could I be joyful? I know it's challenging to be joyful always. So that's a good question. I want to be joyful, I can. So how could I be joyful always? Not to mention all these personal issues I have on top of these social issues. Let's get back to today's passage, verse 41. I'll rejoice in doing them good. God promised, I'll rejoice in doing them good. And the same joy of God, the Father, is manifested in the person of God, the Son. If you keep reading the Bible, Hebrews 12:2 is a good example. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who, help me out here, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. Christ endured the cross for the joy of giving us the new life. He was joyful. He didn't die at the cross grudgingly. He was happy to to die for his people. So again, God is a happy God even at the cross. Christ put himself on the cross because he wanted to. Then what happens in John? John 15:11 reads, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." In its context, Jesus says, the famous, "I'm the vine, you're the branches. Apart from me, you cannot do anything." He just talked about true obedience in the eyes of God. Then he says, verse 11, why? Why would he say this? Because those who cling to Jesus, those who abide in Jesus, could truly obey. Therefore, being a Christ follower means you share the same joy with Christ, the joy that Christ gives. In other words, you rejoice in the things that God the Son rejoices if he abides in you. For example, you love to be alone and do your own thing. Read books or watch TV or play with your computer. You didn't want to be bothered by anyone. You didn't want to bother anyone except for your spouse. But now you love to be with your church. It's your joy to be surrounded by those who love Jesus. Why would you take pleasure in God's people so much like that? What changed you? It's because God loves his people and takes pleasure in him. Psalm 147:11, but the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. God's joy became your joy. You didn't really care about people's stories, their testimonies, but now you love to hear about it when people get saved. So it's your joy to be at church, especially when someone gets baptized. And you're so happy to tell people of Jesus and see that the gospel is still at work. You hope everyone will know Jesus and get baptized. Why would you take joy in someone else's salvation? Because God rejoices over one soul's salvation. Luke 15:7, just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. And you know the rest. So heaven is the place where everyone rejoices in the things that God takes pleasure in. Some of us used to rejoice in our success or fame. You wanted to be well spoken of. You loved it when people like your post on your Facebook as if you're approval junkie. But now you're satisfied by the fact that Jesus called you and died for you. Luke 10:20. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you. Ministry success. But rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Why would Jesus say this? Because, again, it's God's joy to see one person being saved. Luke 15. So you're satisfied in your own salvation, not in your success. So as you can see, the things that God delights in become the things that you delight in. If these things are your joy, Christ commands rejoice always. When he says that, that may not be really impossible. However, God's ultimate pleasure comes next. I didn't say that yet. So if you were to hear one thing out of this sermon, please know this one. Here's one ultimate object of joy, the joy of God. This is a game changer. Matthew 3, 16 and 17. When Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased." The God the Father takes pleasure in God the Son. God delights in God. John 16, 13, and 14. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will glorify me, Christ, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. When the Holy Spirit comes, he will glorify the Son. And God, the Holy Spirit, loves to magnify the Son. You see? Both God the Father and God the Holy Spirit take pleasure in God the Son. When they glorified Christ, they say, "My pleasure." In other words, God's ultimate pleasure is his own Son, his own glory. So if we abide in Christ, we also take pleasure in Christ. God's pleasure in himself becomes my pleasure. Then, Christians, what's your ultimate pleasure? Jesus Christ is your ultimate pleasure. Even if you don't have anything, if you have Christ, you have it all. You're satisfied in the Son, who is the glory of God. Yes, it's tough to love your spouse selflessly sometimes. But instead of saying, "What a hellish marriage, I'm out of here," you know, it's Jesus' joy to magnify himself in your broken relationship. And you go, "My pleasure." And you work on your marriage because Jesus is magnified somehow in your broken relationships. No, it's not easy to go through another chemo, but you say, "I know my God is not a sadistic God, but he desires to see Jesus lifted high through my cancer. And that's my joy as well. When Jesus is lifted high, I love it. And Jesus knows my pain. So I'll fight it for the glory of Jesus. It's my pleasure." I know some people support Black Lives Matter. Some people support White Lives Matter. The others don't. Some people hate all cops because they think they're bad, but the others love the good cops. Our country is divided. Our politics is messy. Our economy is unstable. But Jesus takes pleasure in his own glory through all these things. Why would Jesus allow all these things to happen? Because he wants to be magnified in them. It's his joy to glorify himself, and it's our joy to see Jesus lifted high in all these things. So I do everything I can to serve my country, to see Jesus lifted high. Pleasure is mine. That's Christian. That's a Christ follower. And the good news is that Christ will give us the sovereign joy, so we will rejoice in Christ, regardless of our circumstances. So last point, number two, is receive the joy of Christ. Receive the joy of Christ. Christ has ratified a new heart, purified our conscience at the cross once for all. We know it, it's done, but Christ gives us his joy throughout the sanctification process until we see Jesus face to face. This means that the believers are to cling to Christ in order to receive his joy. However, this also means that we don't get saved by our joy level. Joy is not our works or our righteousness. Salvation is by grace. It's not by how joyful I am. Verse 40, and I'll put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. As you can see, the new covenant is relational. It's not tit for tat. God makes a vow to build a relationship with his people, so it's by grace, not by their works. He wants his people, not their performance. So this has been in the background of the new covenant. Just in the preceding chapter, God says the following before he gives the new covenant. Chapter 31, verses 3 and 4 reads, behold, I'll bring them from the north country and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth. Among them, the blind and the lame and the pregnant woman and she who is in labor together. A great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with pleas for mercy I'll lead them back. I'll make them walk by brooks of water in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Then God gave the new covenant. You see? The new covenant itself stems from the grace of God. Why would God save? Because they're God's children, not because they perform. God's people are saved not by their performance, but by grace. Christ saves you because you are his child, not because you prove to be his child. He is a wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So we just need to respond to the grace, receiving the joy of Christ, which is Christ himself. Can we all stand and read the following passage as our worship to Christ? Let us all stand. Philippians 4:4. In one voice, let us all read it. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I'll say, rejoice. Christ is our ultimate joy. Treasure him, church. This is the word of God. All God's people said, thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your grace and mercy. We stand here in awe of your sovereign joy, and help us rejoice in Christ regardless of our personal issues, regardless of politics, regardless of economy, regardless of all these worries and problems in the world, help us rejoice in Christ because God rejoices in God. Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.